Well, hey there. So, if you're watching this video, you probably need a computer. But when you look online, you're like, oh, that's money. But what if I told you there is a solution? So, if you know my content, you know I preach the good word about old computers. Maybe it's a desktop. Maybe it's a laptop. Maybe it's a little micro PC like this. And I know what you must be thinking. This has to be too old to do anything like decent with it. Well, let's see if I can change your mind by the end of this video. First and foremost, this is an OptiPlex 7050 Micro. And it's about 7 or 8 years old, but it's got some pretty sweet parts in there. And the crazy thing is, I got this for $53 on eBay. And don't get me wrong, I could have gotten a bigger computer, which would have let me put in like a graphics card and all that, but don't worry guys, I got a plan. And yes, the laptop prices are also pretty reasonable. But before we go too crazy, I went ahead and popped the screw here, and we can just take it out from the front, and bam, we got the internals. So the one thing I want you guys to keep in mind is we're not seeing the giant performance leaps in performance that we saw, like, let's say back in the 90s, 80s, early 2000s, okay? If you get something from the past like 10, 15 years, you can make it do some crazy stuff. So while this computer is technically out of date, guys, the parts in here when it was released are pretty stellar. The number one rule that I will tell you is if you're buying a used PC, get something that had great parts at the time. The number one thing I look for is a good processor. In this case, I got a 6th generation i5 processor. So if you get yourself something with, let's say, a Ryzen 5, Ryzen 7, an Intel i5, an Intel i7, guys, you're going to be set. And the beautiful thing is, because of the age of the machine, the parts are super freaking cheap. So you can make this thing a beast for next to nothing. Or, of course, whatever machine you decide to pick up. Again, get a bigger desktop if you want the GPU, because it won't fit in this little one. So this one that I bought didn't come with any kind of storage, but it has compatibility for both a little 2.5-inch hard drive, which is the kind that you'd put inside of a laptop, or a more modern standard called an NVMe. And if we go ahead and zoom in and we look right here, this M.2 slot, this is where we're going to put the NVMe. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry, it'll all make sense by the end and you'll see it's super easy to do. And next, we're going to go ahead and pull these little clips right here to where we can remove the cooling system, which is going to reveal the next wonderful part of the equation, our DDR4 RAM. Now, when it comes to RAM, you want to try to get the newest standard you can. Right now, when I'm recording this video, it's DDR5, but DDR4 RAM, which is, you know, just a little bit less powerful, is super cheap right now. And if you even end up with something like DDR3 RAM, it's still not bad. And if I go ahead and undo these little clips right here and I pull this out, we can see that this is a 8GB SODIMM, again, the kind that we'd find in a laptop. And we'll just go ahead and slot it back in and push it down, and bam, it's installed. And another beautiful thing is we have a second one to where we can make it even more beefy, which I'm actually not gonna do because, again, I've got a plan. And this is our heatsink right here, and underneath that is our processor, which we gotta do something kind of important, which, again, super easy. I'm just gonna take this screwdriver from my toolkit, which you can find a link for in the video description, and I'm gonna go ahead and take this heatsink off. And with the screws loosened, we just pick it up, and there, oh my gosh, it has really crusty paste. All right, guys, this is the entire reason why I do this step here, because right here is the brain of the computer. Brain of the computer likes to get super hot, and, you know, you have the paste right there, which then brings the heat to the heatsink, and then gets blown out by a fan. And when it is this freaking ancient, this ain't cooling nothing. And this is where I'm gonna bring up my number one rule, regardless of how you get a computer. I don't care if it's used, I don't care if it's new. Replace the thermal paste. You don't know when the machine was last maintained. You don't know who did the thermal paste last. Like, if you got it from the factory, you don't know if they did it right. As an example, this is my gaming laptop. This is one of my most frequently used devices, and when I got it brand freaking new from the factory, it had the heatsink installed improperly. You kind of go corner by corner by corner and slowly twist it in on each side until it, like, screws down entirely, you know, just a half turn, so on and so forth. But it was like the person that installed it, like, tightened down the top and then the other side, like, completely and pushed all the thermal paste out the other side to where only half the chip was covered. Which, when I was first using the laptop and just, you know, test running it to see, hey, how's it working? Before I did the thermal paste replacement, I was getting some gnarly thermal issues, which is not good for the laptop because, well, it kills the machine. And when you buy a machine on eBay that is refurbished, which I don't think this one was listed as it, but I've seen it with machines that are listed as refurbished, they're usually not refurbished. They dust the thing out and they never replace the thermal paste, and that's really not good. Because you want to replace the thermal paste in your computer at least every 4 years. That way it stays nice and goopy and it keeps your machine running cool. And how do you replace thermal paste? Easy! You get yourself some paper towels and some 91% alcohol, or whatever alcohol you have. I just like using 91%. So I'm gonna take a piece of paper towel and I'm gonna get it good and drenched with alcohol, and I'm gonna use it to wipe off all this old thermal compound on the heatsink. And if you're on a laptop, generally speaking, the processor is going to be, like, built into the board, as well as a GPU that might have its own thermal paste, but that's everything all together. And if it's a desktop CPU, it's super easy. We're just gonna go ahead and release this little clamp right here. There we go. And we can open up this compartment here to get access to the CPU. And guys, removal is super easy. We just need to go ahead and get a finger in here. And we're going to very carefully grab it, making sure not to touch the bottom here. And we're going to make sure to pay attention to the pins. And this is for Intel CPUs. It's backwards on AMD. And we're going to go ahead and do the same thing to this. We're just going to clean off any thermal paste that's here. And honestly, this one probably doesn't need to be cleaned as badly because it was so dry, it all just came off. And there we go. With the power of alcohol and elbow grease, we got these cleaned up. Now, one thing you'll notice on the processor are these little teeth right here, which correlate to these points right here on the CPU socket. And when we go to reinstall the CPU, we're just going to aim for those little teeth right there. We're going to go ahead and get it in the corner and plop her down just like that. And then we're just going to put down this little thing here. We're going to go ahead and make sure it locks into this point, this little screw doodad thing. And we'll push that in, and there we go, it's secure. Now, it's also super important to use some quality thermal compound. I love Arctic MX4, which is why I have a giant tube of it that you've seen this exact tube show up many times on this channel, because I just can't get it to run out. And the goal will be to put a pea-sized dot right in the center here. The heat and the pressure is going to distribute it across the processor. And as one more golden rule, okay, you can have a little too much thermal paste, it isn't gonna kill it, but if you have too little thermal paste, you're gonna have a heating problem. So I put a nice gloopy blob right there, which some people are gonna say, oh, that's too much, but again, it's really not gonna matter. The computer's not gonna notice. In fact, it's gonna be thrilled. And next, we're gonna take the heat sink again, and we're just gonna put it back into these screw holes, making sure that it is aligned up, and we're gonna go through the screwing in process once I have this plopped on. All right, so we got the heat sink put down right here. It is not screwed in yet, because we're going to make sure we do it the right way, unlike the guy that did my laptop. Side tangent, the tripod that I was using to make this video just crapped out of me, so I can't adjust it anymore. Please check out the Patreon and donation links if you can help me get a new one. Guys, I had to bust out old reliable, which is way too uncomfortable to work around, and I'm sorry if that makes the camera angles a little worse. So guys, this next part is super easy. All we're gonna do is we're gonna go around and we're gonna make sure the screws get threaded in. We're gonna give them each a couple little twists here, okay? Just enough to where it is feeling like it's making a connection. And we're just gonna go corner to corner. We're gonna give each of them a little turn, and we're just gonna go back to the screw that we started with and do it in the same order until it's tightened all the way. That way the paste is again spread evenly. And there we go, we got it secured. So now I'm just gonna go ahead and put the fan back on, and we'll go to the next step. And there we go, now I can actually call this thing refurbished. Now the next step, we need to add some storage to this. And remember, again, the price of this machine was $53, and it already had the RAM, so we just needed a little bit of storage, which this was only 40 bucks. And I know some of you are gonna think, well, why didn't you just do a SATA SSD? Those are cheaper. And see, that's what I thought when I looked them up, but no, this costs just as much. And this is actually gonna be a lot faster than a SATA SSD, and the best part is it is a 500 gigabyte, and I only need 240 gigs for the project I'm gonna do, so this is perfect for me. And one more thing of note is, again, get a quality part. This is by Crucial. They do good stuff, the best of the best of Samsung, but they cost a lot more money. So we got ourselves our NVMe, which we're gonna install into that M.2 slot right there. The problem I have is that they didn't include a screw, which I do have spares, but if you end up buying this particular drive, just, I guess, pick up a screw. Keep in mind, most NVMe's are gonna come with a screw, which is why this is kind of shocking to me, but, you know, they're super cheap online if for whatever reason you end up with one that doesn't have the screw. And again, this install is super duper easy. We're gonna see this little tooth right there, which has a corresponding tooth on the M.2 slot. Now, there are different kinds of like teeth configurations, so just make sure you get the M.2 that matches your particular machine. Or if you wanna go the easy way, if it supports SATA, use SATA, but you know, this is better. It's just, you know, you just gotta pay attention to that one little detail. Even better, they left one in the computer for me. I love it when I get free spare parts. And guys, this install super easy. All we gotta do is we gotta aim that to the right down range just like that, pop it in to make sure it's flush, and then we're gonna press it down and put the screw in. Already using the spare parts. And just like that, we got storage. And there we go, guys. That's everything I'm gonna be upgrading on this machine. Now, there is one more thing I'm gonna point out for you guys in case you wanna change one thing that I'm gonna do with this. So you might have noticed right here that we have another M.2 looking thingy right there, and that is in case we wanted to add a wireless chipset to it, which I was considering, but I didn't want to route the antenna, so I got lazy and I picked these up. I got a nano wireless adapter that's going to remain in the back, and this Ugreen Bluetooth 5.3 wireless dongle. Now, if you're hooking up to a hardwire Ethernet, you really don't need these. You know, I wanted Wi-Fi in case I wanted to do updates, and I wanted Bluetooth for reasons that will become apparent very soon. So, since I'm not going to be installing that, I'm just going to go ahead and put this thing back together, and we're going to see what we can do. And there we go, the beautiful beast is reassembled. So now that we have the computer assembled, we're going to still need a couple things, you know, get this up and running. kidding. This came with a power cord, so I don't need to think about that. But what about a keyboard, mouse, and monitor? And guys, my number one recommendation has to be thrift stores. Generally speaking, you can get a mouse and a keyboard for under 10 bucks, as well as a monitor for under 20. To give you guys an idea, this monitor right here is a $7 one I got at Goodwill. But the display I'm going to be using is this 4K TV that I got for $35 at Goodwill. And I can already hear this in the comment section, but this only has HDMI 1.4, which means this one's going to be able to output at 4K at 30 FPS, which is or 1080p at 60 FPS. But my friend, you are neglecting one thing, the fact that I have a plan. So I went ahead and plugged in the power, plugged in the HDMI, and now we're going to see how it works. We got power and we have output going at 1080p. And now I've plugged in a mouse and a keyboard that's bigger than the computer. So this is a weird piece of advice, but some computers don't agree with gaming keyboards. So go to Walmart, get like the cheapest $20 keyboard you can, or again, hit up your Goodwill for like $5 and use one of those. At least for these next steps we're gonna take for the initial setup, and then you can use whatever you want. So the next thing we're gonna do is install an operating system on the device, and I know what some people have probably already said in the comment section, but this is an old device, no TPM 2.0, that means no Windows 11. And that is where you are wrong, my friend, because in Rufus, we can press the start button right here with the Windows 11 ISO, and it gives us the chance to bypass all those things. That said, I am not gonna put Windows 11 on this thing because I wanna get the most performance for the hardware that's in there, so you already know what we're doing. It's gonna be Linux. And if you want my explanation for why Linux and how to install Linux, I have previous videos on the subject, which will take you through the entire process, which I'm not gonna show in this one because this is already gonna be a long video. And the best part is we're only gonna show this temporarily because this is not the end goal. I have a different version of Linux that you guys have never seen me talk about before. Unless you're on TikTok, then it showed up once, but I said everything all together. So this will be the one part of the equation where you probably have to borrow someone's computer so you can make your own flash drive to install the operating system. But if that's not an option, you can go online and get flash drives that are like pre-installed with an operating system, so you can just like boot from that, do your install, and you're good to go. Ah, the joys of installing a quality operating system. And if you followed my guide on installing Zorin Linux, which you can find in the video description, then hey, there we go, we got an operating system now. And guys, as I've got some stuff updating here, I just needed to show you that, look, the performance is not doing too bad. It's spiking here and there because, you know, I'm running updates right now while I'm playing a video, and just like I showed in the other videos where I've shown off Zorin Linux, this is blazing fast. And again, guys, that's really the point here is, again, this is an old computer that is handling this absolutely phenomenally. And again, it's great for like schoolwork and stuff. It even has like things built in. So, you know, schoolwork, office work, you can use it for media playback. You can use it for some like gaming, which we're going to be showing off, and all kinds of other things. It's a great computer. And remember, she be ancient. And I also want to point out it has a built-in speaker. Now, if getting the computer up and running was the end goal, then we'd be done. We would have ourselves an operating system. We could use the computer for whatever we wanted to, and we'd be set. But you remember that plan we were talking about? Now it's time to show you guys. My friends, we have turned this into something amazing. We've installed one additional thing off camera, and that is Batisera Linux. Batisera Linux is basically a Linux distribution that converts your old computer or even like Raspberry Pis and stuff into a game system. And what I did is I took the NVMe out of the system and I used this little external adapter here to where I could flash the operating system directly to the NVMe. And then I used a thrift store external hard drive to start transferring over files that I wanted to use with the operating system. And it's extremely desirable for this project because I can control the OS with a controller. It's also nice because you're able to set up custom things like different theming and whatnot. You know, it's able to play all these different game systems, which is pretty cool. And I added my own background music to it because, well, I wanted something more vibey. And look, we already know that it's going to be able to run all of the basic stuff because, well, everything can run the basics. So let's throw something more intense at it. And I'm sure you guys saw the Steam library as we were starting. So let's go ahead and open that up. And I went ahead and installed a few titles here just to get an idea. So guys, we got to start off with Half-Life 2, which I just want to show you guys. Here's all the settings we have configured, so it's pretty cranked. And guys, this performance is absolutely stellar. Like, I'm just playing on this little controller right here, but like, it does not struggle at all. And again, this is just a little freaking micro PC. It's handling this, like, perfectly. And yes, that does include when things get a little more dicey and you gotta do some combat. And to take it up another generation, here's the Steam version of Fallout 3. So it did set the defaults too high, so I do need to crank down a little bit because we are seeing some FPS issues, but, that's kind of expected. Again, this is a completely Intel build. And with the graphics turned down, this is actually at a playable frame right now. And guys, it shrugs off emulation like it's nothing. PS1 was stellar, so let's jump right into the PS2. And guys, as you can see, we are playing without any kind of an issue right now, which is really impressive because I have more modern devices that can't even do this. So, yeah, I'm a fan. And the same can be said about the Wii. I mean, guys, look at how this is working. This is amazing.
And guys, don't get me wrong. This is absolutely amazing. I wanted to be able to have this as a good backup to the primary use case. And what is that primary use case?
Dance Dance Revolution!
Yeah, I'm not kidding. This is my primary use case. Ultimately, I just wanted a more efficient way to play the game because I would normally have to move my laptop over the TV, but now I'll have a device just attached to the back of the TV that I can just start up and play. And I also wanted something I could just control with the dance mat. And this actually leads to this last part of the setup where I'm gonna set this Stepmania app to launch on boot. And now I'm gonna go ahead and turn on the computer and we're gonna see how it starts up. And there we go, just like I hoped, it started right into Stepmania right on boot, which means I can just plug in my Dance Dance, turn on the PC, and then, you know, it goes right into the game. But anyway, guys, that is just my short and sweet introduction to why I love old computers and what you can really do with them. And if you found any part of this helpful, please check out the links in the video description if you want to support the page, or you can just simply like, comment, subscribe, share, and I will see you guys in the next video.